Aliona, though she speaks perfect Russian and feel herself at least a big part of her is Russian, but she grew up in Holland, and you were 2.5 when you moved there, 2.5, but still Russia is a subject of most of her films, and she is kind of Peter the Great, the opposite to Peter the Great. Peter the Great tries to open for us a window to Europe, and she tries to open the window for Holland public and for the world to Russia in a certain point. And she is actually a classic of Holland documentary, who produced six films which were internationally awarded, and most of them about Russia. And it's also a very special evening because we have a friend of Boris Ryzhy with us, Oleg Dozmorov, who was with him very closely, who grew up with him. So it's an evening about Yekaterinburg because of 90s, because this is the subject of the film. And this is also about this subject. Oleg is going to speak, and he's going to speak about Boris, tell something about Boris, and read some poetry of Boris, and I'll ask an English poet to read a translation of Sasha Gabgalen to tell a couple of words about the translator. So we'll start with some storytelling with Oleg, and with a couple of words about Boris, and with some verses, and then go on.
Я бы хотел сначала немного рассказать о Борисе Рыжем, о том бэкграунде, о том, откуда он, и о его литературной судьбе. Буквально несколько моментов.
I would like to start with the background, where Boris Ryzhy is from, and just to, so we can see the bigger context, and so it'll be easier to understand who this person was.
И вам потом будет интереснее и проще следить в фильме за вот превращением этого прошлого в стихи.
And then it will be easier for you to follow how this process of how it's happened, how his poems were born.
Борис Ryzhy родился в 1974 году в Челябинске. И когда ему было 7 лет, его семья переехала в Свердловск. Это 200 километров от Челябинска.
He was born in 1974 in Челябинск, and later on his family moved to Свердловск. Когда ему было 7 лет?
7 лет.
When he was 7 years old.
Which became Yekaterinburg.
Yes,
yeah.
No.
Not.
Just to remember.
Yes. Sorry, a few details which are sort of.
Just to remember. Он вырос в культурной, очень образованной семье. Его отец Борис Петрович Ryzhy был профессором геологом минералогических наук, известным геофизиком в России. А мама его была медиком, она возглавляла санэпидемстанцию в Свердловске.
Борис Ryzhy grew up in a very cultured Belgian family. His parents were highly educated. His father was a professor. He was a geologist, a physicist, and his mother was a doctor. Yeah, she specialized in epidemiology.
И они занимали довольно высокое положение в обществе советском. Также надо отметить, что дед Бориса по отцу был секретарем райкома в Курганской области. А Борис Петрович Ryzhy, его отец Бориса, он долгое время возглавлял парторганизацию «Урал-геология». Это большой трест, геологический трест, который вел разработки поиск руды, поиск сырья и так далее.
His family actually was, I mean, his, it was, his family was actually in a very good position to say in a Soviet system, because for example his paternal granddad was secretary of the regional committee of the CPSU, the Communist Party, and his father Boris Petrovich also was the head of the Communist Party organization at his work. So and he worked at a very big organization, Oral Geology, which if you consider former Soviet Union history, this organization was quite big and influential. So both his father and grandfather were involved in the work of Communist Party.
Он открыл три месторождения урана на Урале.
And his father was actually the person who discovered three main uranium
Я к чему это говорю? Потому что когда семья Бориса приехала в Свердловск в 1981 году, они поменяли квартиру Челябинскую на Свердловскую, не зная района города, куда они попадут. Они попали в район в Торчермет. Это название идет от завода вторичной черной металлургии, который там располагался.
So when Boris family moved to Svetlovsk, modern Ekaterinburg, in 1981, actually they didn't know, because they just exchanged flats, and they didn't know what area they were living. And actually this area was called Vtorchermet, and it's actually the area where there was a big plant where they, metallurgy, they actually reworked metals.
Recycling
plant.
Из интеллектуальной, интеллигентной среды в Челябинске они переместились на окраину, рабочую окраину Свердловска, что было большим, конечно, контрастом для Бориса, и это, мне кажется, его сформировало.
So, if in
Свердловск
they lived in a, let's say, very culture area of the city, but then Chelyabinsk. Yeah. But in Sverdlovsk they moved into the working class suburb. And obviously for Boris it was maybe a bit of shock to change completely the social background.
And
it affected actually the formation of his character.
Vtorchermet, это район, где располагаются три или располагались, сейчас, может быть, какие-то предприятия закрылись, три завода, куда брали людей с судимостью на работу. Больше никуда не брали, на оборонные предприятия не брали, естественно, на важные какие-то стратегические предприятия не брали, а вот на жиркомбинат, завод резиновых изделий, мясокомбинат, и вот в Торчермет, сам вот этот завод в Торчермет, брали людей с судимостью.
So we say working class suburb, but this was very special suburb because there were three plants in this area, and they accepted people who had criminal past. And for these people who had criminal past, it was very difficult to find any job. But these three plants, like the rubber plant and meat recycling, meat plant and stuff. So they actually accepted these people. So you can imagine, it's not only working class suburb, but it's also people who live there, people who had some criminal past. So they were imprisoned or they were released after being some time in prison.
Да. Конечно, это были контрасты очень большой силы, которые внутри Бориса жили, и они, я думаю, разрывали его вот ментально очень сильно. Я не знаю, английский сказать, но вот именно так.
So this huge contrast with different social backgrounds where young Boris sort of moved from one social background to another, they actually affected him very, very powerfully. And that was the reason of many, maybe, processes which actually affected his creativity later on.
Ну, представьте, его отца возили на служебной машине с работы домой. Борис выходил во двор и видел там вот то, что вы видите в фильме. И Почти ничего не изменилось. Вот, да, Алена не даст соврать. Почти ничего не изменилось с того времени, когда мальчик там Борис Ryzhy бегал по этому району в шортах. И сейчас так примерно так же вся жизнь там и устроена.
So you can imagine that, for example, that Boris's father had a personal car. I mean, he was provided by a car by his work, and so they were driven, his family was driven by a personal driver. But then when Boris went out, so the people surrounded him were very ordinary people, and so what you can see here is still the same. I mean, the situation in this area, they're very, very ordinary people.
В этом фильме я бы хотел несколько слов о его литературной судьбе сказать. Значит, вот литературная судьба его была беспрецедентно успешна. К 25 годам он был известным поэтом, получил одну из самых престижных российских литературных премий «Антибукер». У него вышла книга, первая и единственная прижизненная его книга вышла в очень престижном издательстве поэтическом Санкт-Петербургском «Пушкинский фонд».
But his literary fate was very, very successful because he achieved success when he was only 25 years old. And the first award, a very prominent award, Anti-Booker Prize, he received when he was 25, yeah? 24. Came over 24. And his 25, yeah. And his first book was published in St. Petersburg in 2000, yeah? And so for a young person it was quite a big success.
Да, не с чем сравнить, потому что в поколении Бориса больше не было, наверное, таких молодых поэтов, вышедших читателю так триумфально и со стихами такого уровня в этом возрасте.
So his success was unparalleled comparing with other maybe young poets of his age.
Вот я покажу вам, это единственная его прижизненная книга, которая вышла буквально за год до его самоубийства. Вот она подписана мне, я тут немножко похвастаюсь. Дорогому Олегу, что-то вроде отчета о проделанной подрывной работе в области изящной словесности. Вот я бы хотел немного поговорить о этой подрывной работе, проделанной Бориса.
So this book actually was published 1 year before his suicide, and this book was presented to Oleg, and actually it's signed to Dear Oleg, something like a report about my subversive activities in the area of Russian studies.
В чем заключалась эта подрывная работа? Ему удалось выйти к массовому читателю. Сейчас не при жизни, конечно, потому что тогда только все начиналось. А сейчас я просто вам покажу книги, которые сейчас выходят в России. Вот у нас с собой практически все книги, которые вышли Бориса с его гибели. Вот эта вот книга тоже в Пушкинском фонде вышла в Петербурге. Потом вышла вот эта книга в Эксмо, большим довольно тиражом. Вот эта книга вышла в издательстве «Фактория», тоже большим тиражом, по-моему, 3000 экземпляров. Это большой тираж очень, 3000
экземпляров. Can I just say that this is a book which actually was published when Boris was alive, and all these books were published after his death. And it's actually, they were published like 3,000 copies, and for Russia it's quite a big number. So it's huge success also that posthumous.
Да. Вот эта книга вышла, это последняя из вышедших книг.
The last book.
Да, она переиздавалась уже три раза по 3000 экземпляров.
So it was published three times, every time 3,000 copies.
И общий тираж таким образом составляет около 20, наверное, тысяч, ну больше 15 тысяч.
Yeah, so it's around 15-20,000 copies all in all.
Для современного поэта российского это огромный тираж.
For a modern Russian poet, it's quite a huge success.
Для не эстрадного, не интернет-поэта, ну не хочется никого. Ну, вы знаете Веру Полоскову, допустим, да? Вот это другого плана поэзии. Вот для высокой книжной поэзии такие тиражи в России сейчас удивительны.
So he wasn't anywhere on the stage, or he wasn't famous because of the internet publicity. So for high class, real literature, real poetry, it's quite a big success and triumph.
И мы с Борисом общались, и как два молодых поэта с 96 года мы дружили. И ну вот я в маленьком ролике рассказывал эту историю, сейчас, может быть, повторю ее. Мы друг другу рассказывали всякие страшные истории из нашего детства и юности.
So we knew each other from 1996, we befriended each other, and we were very open to each other, and told each other stories from our past, which were sometimes very frightening.
Потому что, ну, вот, маргинальный контингент, так скажем, не знаю, сказать, люди с криминальным прошлым, они жили, конечно, везде в городе, не только на Шереметье. Вот, и мои соседи были такими же. Я рассказывал Борису истории из жизни своих соседей, как там кого-нибудь убили в подъезде, страшные истории. Борис рассказывал истории, как у них соседа где-то там тоже около подъезда. Ну, это, понимаете, это нормально было. Это как-то вот, может быть, сейчас это пугает, но вот в то время, в 90-е годы, это даже смешило нас.
So we told each other stories, and these stories were quite similar, because we had, for example, one of our neighbors was killed, a block of flats, and, you know, and he had the same stories, and all these killings were just considered as normal thing, because situation in the end of 1990s was quite horrible in former Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. Can vouch for that. And and for many reasons, it looked like the norm for many people, and for both these young poets, as you know, so they shared the stories. And this horror, which actually became, for many reasons, the norm. And it was even funny, black humor. It's funny.
Но вдруг после очередной истории Борис стал серьезным и сказал: Олег, а ты знаешь вообще, в чем разница? Разница в том, что я этих людей любил.
But once Boris told me, you know, what's the difference? The difference is that I actually loved these people.
Это действительно так, он этих людей любил. И какое-то чувство вины, может быть, перед ними испытывал, и часто о них говорил, и они все попали в его стихи, которые устроены как маленький такой вот городок или маленький мир, где эти люди обрели, ну, вот, может быть, вечную жизнь.
And it's true that he loved them, because thanks to him, thanks to the world he created, like a small city or town, where all these characters, they traveled from the reality into his poems, and sort of thanks to him, because of his love, real love, they actually exist now in his poetry, in his poems.
Я прочитаю несколько стихотворений, в которых, может быть, это будет заметно. Три из этих стихотворений имеют английские аналоги, английский перевод, английскую версию. Они тоже будут озвучены здесь. Но я начну со стихотворения программного для Бориса, которое не имеет английской версии. В всяком случае, мы не нашли.
Alex says that he would like to read now some poems of Boris, and three of them, they were translated into English, but one of them, which he thinks is very important for his poetry, wasn't translated. So I don't know how we manage, but we'll try to, the most important poem from Alex's point of view.
Вот это программное стихотворение. Так гранит покрывается наледью, и стоят на земле холода. Этот город, покрывшийся памятью, я покинуть хочу навсегда. Будет теплое пиво вокзальное, будет облако над головой, будет музыка очень печальная. Я навеки прощаюсь с тобой. Больше неба, тепла, человечности, больше черного горя, поэт. Ни к чему разговоры о вечности, а точнее о том, чего нет. Это было над Камой крылатою, сине-черную, именно там, где беззубую песню, бесплатную, пушкинистом кричал Мандельштам. Уркаган, разбушлатившись в тамбуре, выбивает окно кулаком, как Григорьев, гуляющий в таборе, и на стеклах стоит босиком. Долго по полу кровь разбивается, долго капает кровь с кулака, а в отверстие небо врывается, и лежат на башке облака. Я родился, доселе не верится, в лабиринте фабричных дворов, в той стране голубиной, что делится тысячу лет на ментов и воров. Потому уменьшительных суффиксов не люблю, и когда постучат и попросят с улыбкой уксуса, я исполню желание ребят. Отвращение, домашние кофточки, полки книжные, фото отца вызывают у тех, кто на корточке, сев, умеет сидеть до конца. Свалка памяти разная, разная, как сказал тот, кто умер уже. Безобразное — это прекрасное, что не может вместиться в душе. Слишком много всего не вмещается. На вокзале стоят поезда. Ну, пора. Мальчик с мамой прощается. Знать, забрили болезного. Да, ты пиши хоть, сынуль, мы волнуемся. На прощание страшнее рассвет, чем закат. Ну, давай поцелуемся. Больше черного горя.
Sasha Dugdale, who's the editor still, she's about to step out, but she's been editor of Modern Poetry and Translation, which was the main translation journal set up in 1966 by Ted Hughes in this country, and edited for a long time by Daniel Weisbrot, set up by Ted Hughes and Daniel Weisbrot. Sasha's a translator from Russian. I'm just standing in for her, so I'm reading her words, and I also don't know whether the translations are finalized in her mind, but I think it's important, well, for me at any rate, to hear the poems of this poet in English in London. Primarily in Russian, but also it's important in English. So many thanks for letting me read.
Does anyone need translation into Russian?
No? This is probably unnecessary for.
Russian first, which is. Если в прошлое лучше трамваем, со звоночком, податым соседом, грязным школьником. Тете с приветом, чтоб листва тополиная следом. Через 5 или 6 остановок въедем в 80-е годы. Слева фабрики, справа заводы. Не тушуйся, закуривай, что ты? Что ты мямлишь скептически? Типа, это все из набоковской прозы. Он Борчук, мы с тобою отбросы. Улыбнись, на лице твоем слезы. Это наша с тобой остановка. Там плакаты, а там транспаранты. Небо синее. Красные банки, чьи-то похороны, музыканты. Подыграй на зубах этим дядям и отчай под красивые звуки. Куртка кожаная, руки в брюки, да по улочке вечной разлуки. Да по улице вечной печали, в дом родимый, сливаясь с закатом. Одиночество, сном, листопадом, возвращайся к убитым солдатам.
Best to take the tram if you're going back to the past, with its bell and the drunk bloke next to you, and the grimy school kids, a mad old girl, and of course the poplar leaves following in its trail. 5 or 6 tram stops later, we ride into the 1980s. Factories to the left, works to the right. No one cares. Get your fags out. What's wrong with you? Such a mumbling, skeptical. Something like that lifted from Nabokov. He was a badger's son, you and I are the leftovers. Come on, smile, there are tears in your face. This is our stop, posters, banners, there and there, blue sky, red neckties, somebody's funeral, musicians playing. You play along to them on your whistle, and then float off to the beautiful sound, leather jacket, hands in your pockets, along that path of unending separation, along that road of unending sadness, to the house where you were born, melting into sunset, solitude, sleep, the molting of leaves, and come back as a dead soldier.
I'm sorry to interrupt, Stephen, it's not Barchuk, not Barsuk. Therefore, the original translation was correct. Barchuk is the son of a pine, of a lord.
I read an incorrect word. It was a word I was unsure of when I wrote the poem.
Здесь англо-русский культурный клуб, поэтому я... Следующий. Городок, что я выдумал и заселил человека, городок, над которым я лично пустил облака, барахлит, ибо жил, руководствуясь некими соображениями, якобы жизнь коротка. Вырубается музыка, как музыкант не старается. Фонари не горят, как не кроет их матом электрик, браток. На глазах, перед зеркалом стоя, дурнеет красавица. Барахлит городок. Виноват, господа, не учел, но она продолжается. Все к чертям полетело. А что называется мной, то идет по осенней аллее. И ветер свистит, надрывается, и клубится листва за моей спиной.
This little town. This little town which I myself dreamt up and settled with people. This little town where I released the clouds into the ether. Is breaking down, for it lived, ruled by certain notions along the lines that life would be short, vita brevis. The music dies out, though the musician does his best. The street lights are on the blink, though the electrician's language is foul. This girl's beauty sours as she looks out in the mirror. This little town is breaking down. Blame me, lads, I didn't allow for it, but life goes on, everything down the pan, and that object they call me, walking an autumn avenue in a gusting, whistling wind, and behind my back, the swirling of the leaves.
Конечно, у него был ранний этап, когда он подражал Бродскому и питерским поэтам, и Кушнер, и, ну, он прошел череду подражаний, ученичеств, но потом вдруг как-то нашел себя и начал писать стихи, которые вот именно стихи Бориса Ryzhyho. Уже не раннего Бориса, а настоящего Бориса.
Mm-hmm. Just very shortly, sorry. Another poem, which you can call a very decisive and very important for his poetry, because there were some stages when he was writing following someone, like for example St. Petersburg poet or maybe Brodsky, but this poem shows real Boris Ryzhyho when he is all by himself. So this is his soul speaking to us, his poetry.
Это удивительно, когда просто мы познакомились с ним как раз вот в те месяцы, когда вот этот этап у него подошел к концу ранний, да, ученический. Такой вот общекультурный, можно сказать. Вот. И вдруг он начал писать совсем другие стихи. Это было поразительно просто.
So, we met exactly at this point, when the first stage of his poetry, when he was still a student, when he was still learning, was coming to the end. And the new stage, when he was becoming his own poet, and we met exactly at this point, at the border of these two stages. Yeah, and it was really, really interesting to see how this process was, you know, happening.
В черной арке всю ночь играл саксофонист. Рапойца на скамейке в парке спал, постелив газетный лист. Я тоже стану музыкантом и буду, если не умру, в рубахе белой с черным бантом играть ночами на ветру. Чтоб, улыбаясь, спал пропойца под небом, выпитым до дна. Спи, ни о чем не беспокойся, есть только музыка одна.
This transition gets a little of the rhyme at all. In a black arc over the travel bar, a saxophonist played all night. A drunkard slept on a bench in the park, stretched out on newspaper sheets. I will also become a musician, and if I do not die, will play into the wind at night in white shirt and black bow tie. So that the drunkard smiles in his sleep, under the emptied out tumbler of the sky. Sleep, don't worry about anything. It's music alone that exists.
Thank you. Важно украшен мой школьный альбом, молотым тяжким и острым серпом. Спрячего, друг, не показывай мне, снова я вижу, как будто во сне. 80-й весь в лозунгах ход, с грозным лицом олимпийцев стоит. Маленький сонный по черному льду, в школу вот-вот упаду, но иду. Мрачно идет вдоль квартала народ, мрачно гудится кварталом звать завод. Песня лихая звучит надо мной, начался, граждане, день трудовой. Все, что я знаю, я понял тогда, нет никого, ничего, никогда. Где бы я ни был, на черном ветру, в черном снегу, упаду и умру. Личка, личка, личка ли, будет мой ангел чернее земли. Рученьки, рученьки, рученьки ру, буду дрожать на холодном ветру. Маленький, маленький, маленький ма, ванная рука, вот выдыхает зима. Аленький галстук на тоненькой шее, греет ли мальчик, тепло ли душе. Все, что я понял тогда, нет никого, ничего, никогда. Где бы я ни был, на черном ветру, в черном снегу, упаду и умру. Будет завод надо мной гудеть, будет звезда надо мной гореть, ржавая в черных прожилках звезда, и никого, ничего, никогда. My school album, respected design, hammer is heavy, sickle is fine. Hide it, my friend, don't show it to me, as if in a dream, again I can see. The 80th many a slowed and filled year, standing, Olympian's face is severe. Sleepy and small, on top of black ice, I walk to school, almost falling twice. Gloomily walks past the block, the crowd, gloomily hums the factory loud. The song so merry I hear overhead, the working day people has started, I said. All that I know, I realize then, there's no one and nothing, regardless of when. Wherever I am, black wind in the sky, out on black ice, I'll fall and I'll die. Little face, little face, little face, leave, my angel, blacker than earth it will be. Little hands, little hands, little hands, hand, tremble within the cold wind that began. Narrow, 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 sleeves, winter breeze and them so far. Scarlet ties wrap round one thin throat. Does it warm you, my boy? Does it warm you, your young soul? All that I know, I realize then, there's no one or nothing, regardless of when. Wherever I am, black wind in the sky, out on black ice, I'll fall and I'll die. Factory will be above me a hum, the star will burn brightly above as it comes, rusty with black veins, the star that is then, and no one and nothing, regardless of when.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good, then Aliona, could you tell a couple of words about...
We can speak more about film.
Afterwards.
I just want to say, I'm from the Netherlands, so I live in Amsterdam. And the Netherlands were the first, I think one of the first countries who translated Boris Ryzhy, because there is a man who kind of, he was the one who discovered first Joseph Brodsky, for the Western audience, and then after, I think, 30 years, he went to St. Petersburg, by accident, met Boris Ryzhy, and he wrote, you know, and he's a poet himself and a very good writer, and he said, you know, this has happened only twice in my life that I recognized a true poet, and after Joseph Brodsky, this is the second time, I really have to say this poet is amazing, and he's an author of many books. And
Case
Virgil. Some people know him as well. So there was a first book of translations, also made by a really, really fine Russian translator of poetry, Anastovol. And when I'd never heard about him, and then there was a bit of resonant alternative music group who always has really great lyrics for their songs, and they used two poems of Boris Ryzhy for their new album. And then Boris Ryzhy already died. It was after his suicide, and his widow came to the Netherlands to kind of for the presentation of the CD of this group, and this is how I met her, and this is how the film actually started. And after it, well, there were more books published, and actually there were more books sold in the Netherlands than maybe in Russia, maybe, because the first had, I think, 3,000 or 4,000, which is a huge amount of everybody has said English, because so I don't need to do this in Russian.
No.
Okay. Otherwise it takes too long. So a lot of Dutch people came to know him through his poetry, and Dutch people are not really poetry lovers, I must confess. So this was really a huge success, and this was also, well, the moment I decided to make a film about it, when I met his widow and I read his poetry to my husband, who was sitting there. And I read it in Dutch and in Russian, and he kind of, you know, and his poems are so transparent in a way. It has many layers, but even when you read it once, it has this magical touch, and which you need when you make a film, because you cannot like have the same poem over and over in a film. And film and television is really a bit at odds with poetry, because you know, it's such an intimate way of reading poetry, and you know, when you see a film, you need to do something with the poems to make it work again for a different medium. Aleg Dozmorov is reading his poems here in this film, but two of them are read. It says also the voice of Boris Ryzhy, and these are the poems he read during his Rotterdam poetry festival. Days, what was left of it, because they were recorded, but there were no other recordings. And there is a bit of archival footage of him by a local TV station who lost the copies, because, you know, they were the 90s, and, you know, so I had like this VHS, you know, you remember VHS, that was the only, what was left of him. And then I met his widow, who was here, and she had to read the poem. She was reading the poem, I remember, when this Dutch musical group was performing, and she read the poem, and then she had to read. She was crying, and there was nobody to console her, and I didn't know her. And, well, and then we got a kind of connection, because it was such an intimate moment for her. And and then I went there to shoot, and I went to a family which was really shattered by the suicide, like everybody. You know, the Olga, who was so nice, for her it was almost a kind of, I don't know, catharsis to go back to the neighborhood with me and talk to the people. And but I remember the first time I phoned her, she just hung up, and she was terribly angry with me, and I didn't know what happened. But this is happening in families when there is a suicide, and it was, everybody had their own memories about Boris. And, oh yeah, and I forgot to tell you, this film was shot in 2007, so it came out in 2008, so Artyom is now grown up, the son, and can see everybody changed a bit. Maybe you have questions.
At the beginning, he is almost hostile to his father. I don't want to speak about him.
Yeah.
I don't want to remember about him.
Yeah.
And at the end, he yeah. opens somehow and tells about his love and about his memories or memory of love or whatever it is.
Yeah, he is just, I'm amazed, he's like 14 years old and I was just blown away by his last answer. Mm-hmm. Like, like, there's love is just not a memory. He corrects me, the memory of love is just, it's really, this is what it's all about. Yeah. And but actually it's also the magic of film, because Artyom didn't want to be filmed. He was really reluctant, and I spoke to his mother and said, like, how can I convince him? And he said, well, you can try, of course, but you have to remember one thing, he has a really stubborn character, so once he said no, it will never become a yes again. So I was like, oh God, how am I going to do it? But, well, I came from the Netherlands, and, you know, I was a bit of, you know, from the country, from Amsterdam, where they smoke weed, so he could talk about, you know, the drugs policy in the Netherlands. So I was a bit the naughty aunt to which he could confess all kinds of things he had as 14 years old. And then actually what happened, he was playing a computer game, he was free because it was he had a holiday from school. He was living, or he was there with his grandmother, and his grandmother was Margarita Mikhailovna, was there, well, talking. That's her way to kind of, you know, process her grief, talking about her son endlessly. And he got really angry about it. So I told him, well, if you want your own part of the story be in this film, you need to talk. I can interview you. And then the interview lasted 20 minutes. I know, because, you know, that in this radio microphone, after 20 minutes of hearing, you have your radio microphone. But I never had, you know, usually you do an interview, last an hour or something, you know, and that was it. So, and the whole kind of process from being hostile to his father to understand his father, in reality, it was not a long time,
Can I ask in this context, a technical question? It's basically a film about faces.
And I'm so happy you said that. You're so right. Yeah.
What sort of conditions you operated, you had to work in, I don't know, for example, shooting these scenes in a courtyard and
trains, etc. Well, that,
I mean, how did you do it? You just waiting for something to happen?
Well, those... So the camera work was like half of it, like the interview with his mother, his friends, his grandmother, all these normal day-to-day scenes with Aliak I did. And the parts where you hear his poems and you see life in the courtyards was made just by, I think, an incredibly gifted colleague and friend of mine, Masha Ohms. And she has this capacity to just disappear. She doesn't speak a word of Russian. You know, Masha is just, you know, her grandmother was Lithuanian. They called her Masha. And she just could, you know, kind of disappear and just smile at everybody. And we were really worried because I was shooting something with my Super 8 camera and she was simultaneously shooting somewhere else. And then we didn't see her for an hour. And for instance, what happened, it was 2007, and the first day we didn't know what to do with, you know, how will we do the poetry in the film, what kind of images are we looking for? So we just went out, and she said, oh yeah, let's try to do slow motion. I said, oh, slow motion with poetry can be really gross. And then it happened to be the 8th of March or something, so International Women's Day, so everybody was drunk. It just happened like that. So the first image we shot at all was the drunken men who were falling. And then we looked back and we just, you know, it was hilarious. It has this feeling of tragical and comical, you know, tragic, comical. And this is also how I felt the neighborhoods and the gazes. And this is also what I told Masha, that, you know, when I was there, the gazes are so strong, you know, nobody's smiling at you. And still sometimes you can see all the pain in the eyes and the suffering. And so it is a film about gazes. And then I went back to Netherlands and I was like, I'm feeling better. Look, what happened? And then I suddenly realized people were actually smiling at me sometimes in public space, which never happened there. So this is a bit how it came about. But I think she just had a keen eye. And actually, we were there. We came especially to Yekaterinburg to find images for the poems. And we were editing at night, and the next day we went and shot something, and then we tried to edit something. So it was kind of a working process. But it was not so hard, because it seems like these kids who are fighting, they were just fighting, it was nothing serious. But in Europe we think like, oh, perestroika, that was a happy time for the Russians. You know, the country went open, but this was really the back side of it. And what happened here happened in, you know, almost all big and small cities in Russia. All this, the whole generation was a lost generation. So he is also called the poet of the last Soviet generation, of the perestroika generation. And what happened to all his friends? Like, I was watching this film, I thought, God. Also with seeing all these kids, seeing all these photos, seeing all these kids now growing up, seeing this friend losing, who is actually a really intelligent, interesting guy. Very strong. He just came out of, he was 3 weeks in a coma because he was being shot here or something. And he was still alive. I think, you know, all this potential of these people who is being broken by the times and the politics and the collapse of a country. And you know, and Boris and Alek and, you know, everybody, they just, you know, the whole generation was growing up in this time. And they all finished school at the moment and when, you know, the country collapsed. And it was like a wartime, you know, when we were ringing the doorbells, everybody had a story of some relative dying in those wild 90s from some, you know, very unnatural death, be it narcotics, which people also didn't know about. It was just imported to the to Russia, and people didn't know how dangerous it was. So the whole generation was like using, I don't know what, the heroin, terrible stuff. Or they died from some, you know, somebody beat them on the head.
The country, the values of the country change in a very little of time. It's called abnomia, the rate of divorce, addiction, and crime, and committing suicide during those days was very high. It was one in a million, one in a thousand. It was, I know that the poets are more sensitive than the others, so they can get depression more than ours, or they are one of his gang. It was a very good film. It was a poetic documentary about a poet. The best thing of this film is that, because it was made in a poetic way, but it was about a poet as well.